Good afternoon, and welcome to this new WhatsApp in Tech webinar. First of all, I would like to introduce myself. I'm Ana Triska, Head of Marketing and Communication in AT Sistemas, Spanish IT services company with a strong expertise in Oracle Fusion middleware. Today, we will discover all the new capabilities of the last ADF release announced by Oracle, ADF 12c. During the next 60 minutes, we will share with you an overview of the most important news on this release, and we will discuss on how you can manage successfully the migration of your system to this new release. If you have any questions during the webinar, you can send them online to us through the questions command of the GoToWebinar system, and we will answer to them during the last 20 minutes dedicated for that. Before introducing the speakers, I want to give just a short information for Spanish speakers. This webinar has been already organized a few weeks ago in Spanish language, and it is online on the YouTube channel of AT Sistemas. Therefore, Spanish speakers, you have also this other possibility to learn more about Oracle ADF 12c. Now it's time to introduce our speakers of today. With us, we have Rubén Iván Agudo, Oracle Business Line Manager in AT Sistemas, and Fernando López Campillo, Software Architect and Technical Leader member of our ADF Expert Center. Hi, Rubén. Hi, Fernando.
Hello,
how are
Ana.
You today?
Fine, thanks.
Fine? Thank ready you. For the webinar?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Let's go.
Okay. Hello, everybody. First of all, I want to start with a few review of the main part of the webinar. I'm going to start with a few introductions of the Oracle Expert Center in AT Sistemas. After that, Fernando will continue with the main technical parts of the webinar where we will talk about new features in GDK and GSA, new ADF components, and ADF and GDeveloper innovations. And finally, we will end with a conclusion and question about the content exposed. So let's go. In AT Sistemas, we have a great team expert in Oracle middleware, especially in ADF. We offer different kinds of services to our clients, sign fixed prices project, support, and professional services. We name Oracle Center Expert. We are group the leaders in Oracle in technology in the company. From the Expert Center, we have support to our teams in different projects, research and development of products like ADF Smart Monitor. You could know more about ADF and Smart Monitor in previous webinars we have in our channel YouTube. After that, we will start with the main part of the webinar. Now we give the control to Fernando. Fernando, all yours.
Thank you very much. Okay, I would like to put my face because it's easier when somebody is talking to you and you can see his face. Well, I always like to, welcome to this new session of WhatsApp in Tech. I always like to start with the most obvious questions about who am I, why we do this, or who is this webinar addressed to, okay? Who am I? Ana already introduced me, but I would like to talk a little bit about what exactly I do in this company. I'm a software architect and also part of the ADF Expert Center. In this case, I'm addressing this webinar just because I'm part of that center, okay? Also, I do training sessions. I also conduct new teams with clients. I make mixed teams to get the best of both worlds, the business knowledge that our clients have and also our technical expertise. Why we do this kind of webinars? Because we like technology and we believe in sharing knowledge. We would like to express to the community that we are a bunch of guys here in Spain, that we are expert on those technologies and we love what we do. This webinar is addressed for developers that already started working with ADF, especially the ones that are not sure about the possibility of jumping from the 10G or 11G to the 12. And also I'd like to express that this is not a master class. You are not going to see here advanced techniques. Perhaps in the near future we are going to go do something like that, okay? Okay, let's go. Now we are going to see the improvement that this new version of 12C has. In this case, in the core part, okay? In this new 12C version, there is a two-steps jump from the JDK 6 to the JDK 8. And for that reason, we are going to get the improvements of both versions. I'm going to show you a little description of some of the most important for us. Of course, that in the performance there are a huge improvements in those new versions, but of course we are focusing the ADF, and for that reason we are going to pay attention about the development itself, okay? In this case, we have default methods in the interfaces. Now we are going to be able to implement default method. We have lambda expressions. I don't know if all of you knows what lambda is. I'm going to try to explain it very shortly. Lambda, it is the significant, it is quite simple. It is a new way of passing block of code to a method, okay? If you have an application that have several threads, you can send to a method a bunch of lines of code in order to be executed, okay? This in reality, you can do that in the past using executables or using methods in order to send them, but this is a new way, an easier way of doing that. Next to that lambda expression, you can see there is an arrow and a system.out, for instance, an example. This is the way that you're going to pass that specific line in order to be executed by another method, okay? Of course, that you have to define a runnable class in order to execute that, but that is the way of passing this kind of expression. Okay, we have also a stream API, okay? This is another way of going through to an object and a stream. This is different to the typical iterator, okay? Those classes, what it does, it is apply a filter, and you are going to get the same information, but it's going to be mapped in another structure, okay? That's not what it is, that API, okay? We have also dates API. This is that comes from Yoda Time, and those are classes that is going to help us in order to handle dates. For instance, we have instant, local date, local time, etc. Okay. We have also a multi-catch. Now, in a try-catch block, you are going to be able to specify more than one exception in one line. You don't have to put one after the other several catches. Okay. Also, we have automatic management of resources. Now, with input streams, output streams, writers, etc., if you specify one of those classes inside of a try-catch, it will automatically close. Now, you don't need to specify the finally method at the end in order to be sure that it's going to be closed, okay? And now, we are going to talk about the JSF framework. Now, we have to be careful of not misunderstand what is what. Okay, when we are talking about JSF, as all of us knows, ADF, it is an implementation of JSF. Okay, and now what we are going to see, it is what have been new, or what are the improvements of the JSF 2.2. But in reality, some of those improvements we had it already in ADF. Okay. This is a list of new improvements. For instance, there is the support of HTML5, it gets richer. There is a full facelet implementation. And now we can almost get rid of the JSPX pages. Now we can fully use JSF. In the JSF 2.2, there is custom components for Ajax. That in ADF we have already for a long time ago, and some of the components we have been using Ajax already. For instance, tables or things like that, okay? We can also specify parameters between pages, okay? With the FViewParam, we are going to be able to specify parameters. Lots of new improvements, composite components, annotations. There is an annotation to register managed bin. You don't need to register them always in the faces config anymore. Also, there are new scopes. I mean, for instance, there are conditional navigation for faces config. This is what in ADF is a router. I mean, it seems that Oracle bought Java a couple of years ago, and then now they are applying some of the solutions of ADF in the core JSF framework as well. Okay, for instance, one of the typical examples is going to be faces flow. I mean, what we have been using for a long time as a task flow in JSF, now it is a faces flow. Okay. We have also the possibility of sending parameters in EL expressions. I mean, in the past, in order to send a parameter to a method in a managed bin or in a machine bin, you have to specify a component inside an F attribute in order to send a value or whatever you want to send. Now, in the same EL expression, you're going to be able to specify that attribute. This is quite handy, and you don't spend too much time doing so much typing, and you're going to do it in the same EL expression, okay? Also, we have events new annotation for events. Okay, let's go through components. Now there is a bunch of new exciting components that is going to help us quite a lot in order to show data in a very fancy way. There are lots of them, of course, that we are not going to go through all of them because the list is quite huge, and the amount of parameters that they have, it is quite unbelievable. I mean, the only thing that you have to look after is your data, is how to query your data in order to show all that data in a visual component. Here we have some examples of those new fancy components. Some of them are really nice. For instance, this is a diagram to show the relation between nodes. If you have several elements and you want to see the relation of them, in this way you're going to be able to see how many of them have much relation with the other. Also, in this timeline component, you are going to be able to see in a timeline the different elements that you want to show. Here also there is a kind of map that shows amounts of things with countries. Also, there are those some bars and tree maps that are quite nice. Okay, let's see three components that are quite new and are quite nice to use, and I will encourage you to use it in your future developments. Those are the code editor, for instance, and now there is a custom made component that is going to allow you to show code with colors like a Node++ or these kind of tools. When you see this kind of component, perhaps you think that you're not going to use it, but for instance, in our company, we have already a product that is called ADF Smart Monitor. It is a monitoring product in order to see ADF, and we have used it already in order to show logs. Instead of showing raw data with no text, no style, if you put colors for dates or for messages, it's going to be nice to see and more useful. Also, we have that component on the left that is the list view component, and this component, following the new wave of think mobile first, those components have been made in the last version in order to show data in a very easy way and very a clear way, and especially because you can see those pages in a device, in a tablet or in a mobile, and you're going to be able to see it quite easily. On the right, we have the deck. Until this 12c version, if you want to show this kind of effects, you have to use jQuery. And now, in ADF, in this version, you're going to be able to use it with a component by itself, okay? Here we have a couple of components that are quite useful, and I would like to show you. On top, there is the panel springboard. This is the typical menu that people use in tablets quite a lot, and it is quite nice to use and quite visual thing. And on the left and the right, you have those kind of menus that is going to help you quite a lot. If, for instance, if you are implementing an application that have been already implemented in Forms, in Forms application sometimes have lots of elements. And in order to be able to show all that information in one screen, this kind of structures is going to help us quite a lot in order to show and hide elements in an intuitive way and having Forms users happy. Okay, now we are going to see the JDeveloper improvements. Of course, that every new ADF version with that ADF version comes from with a JDeveloper new version, and of course it has been improved. Now it loads faster. Also, there is a Maven integration. I would like to talk a little bit more in deep in the next slices, and I will explain you why Maven and in this version it gets quite a lot richer. Okay, it also had JIT integration in the past well, even from the 10G version, we have a subversion client inside JDeveloper. Now we have JIT integration. In our case, we have been using almost always a client outside the JDeveloper just because of the performance, because we have seen as soon as you use your client inside the JDeveloper, the performance of JDeveloper get lower. I hope, or we hope, that in this case they have done a good job and the performance is not going to get influenced, okay? In the debug mode also have been improved quite a lot, and now you can even do modification in the model layer and it will get it without having to restart the JDeveloper. Of course that it gets better, but not always it does what we want. And sometimes, even with in this last version, sometimes you have to restart the machine. Hopefully it's not your case, and you can play with it quite a lot without having to restart it, okay? The design mode also have been getting richer, and now you can specify resolutions and you can play with different browsers, etc. And of course, it's gonna allow you to visualize a little bit more. But of course, you have to think about, this is always something that not always is gonna work, because if you have too many EL expressions that is gonna show a high components, in development time, JDeveloper is not gonna know exactly which objects I have to show or hide, okay? And then it's not gonna work always. Okay, let's talk about ADF itself, all the improvements that have been done in the ADF itself, okay? For me, one of the biggest improvements that Oracle have been done in the last 15 years, it is the look and feel. I don't know if how many of you knows ADF from the 10G version, from the beginning of the version to today. In my case, I've been working with that technology for almost 13 years, and I knew ADF when with the 10G skin, and that was really awful. I mean, almost 90% of the project we had to change the user interface, because there is no client that really likes that skin. Little by little, in those 15 years, Oracle have been improving their skin quite a lot. In my point of view, it is one of the biggest efforts that they have done. In the 11G, with the Fusion skin, the look and feel was a little bit more richer, and a lot of clients already like it. In this new 12C version, there is a new skin, it's called Alta, that for me, it is mind-blowing. I mean, almost 95% of our clients already like it, and we don't have to spend too much time. Well, of course, that sometimes you want to change the layout, but this is the position of elements. But in reality, the look and feel of the elements, almost everybody likes. Right there on the right, you can see the look and feel. For me, I like it quite a lot, and I think they have done it a good job. Okay. Also, there is a new tool. It's called Team Editor, that is gonna help you quite a lot in order to change the skinning. Even if you are using Alta and you want to change it, you are gonna be able to change it to change the font size, the some of the elements. Of course, that editor have limitation. Of course, and those are the more typical things that you can change. But of course, that if your modification get a little bit more complex, you are gonna end up going to the CSS file in order to change them. But you have the first approach in order, especially if you are a beginner, is gonna be quite useful for you. Also, another improvement that ADF have done, it is in the task flow template. Now, you can see in that picture, it's gonna show you in a grid mode what is behind a task flow template. And then if you are new in one project, you don't have to go through all ADF libraries behind those components in order to figure out what is inside. In a blink of an eye, you're gonna be able to see what is behind, okay? Also, in the business component layer, there is an improvement in the entity that now you don't have to, every time that you want to put code in a trigger, for instance, after commit or after insert or things like that, you're gonna be able to put it in with the wizard. You don't have to implement that in a class. And this is nice because as soon as you open an entity, you are going to be able to see the code, and you don't have to go through all the classes in order to see if there is some custom made code in order to specify something. Okay. This is what we call the component. Okay. AF query for the people who have been implementing ADF for a long time knows that component is quite useful, because it gives us a complete solution about perhaps 60% of our application or screens have relation with search and result. Okay, AF query is a component that always helps you to do searches. Okay, that component have several features that is gonna help us in order to do advanced search, to store your searches, to your bookmarks, or things like that. In the past, in the 11G, it was an issue with some of the features. For instance, the order of the elements, or which element do you want to show or hide from the view criteria, or things like that. You don't have full control of those. And for that reason, sometimes in some clients, we end up implementing our own AF queries, because the functionality that already has is not enough for our necessities. In this 12C new version, all those necessities are really implemented, and now we have full control of everything. I mean, we can specify which fields of the view criteria we want. We can specify the width of the fields. We can specify the position of them. There is so many things that we can do in this new AF query that really it is very, very interesting. Also, there is a new property in the view object, it's called RawFinder. The functionality of this, we did it in the past. This is a way of storing searches for internal purposes. I mean, this is not something that you are going to use in the UI layer. You are going to use it programmatically. I mean, if you have already a view object that have a view criteria and have several fields that you can search for, you can specify a row finder for that view criteria and store by default those kind of searches, okay? This is what it does really, it creates a new row set in order to don't damage your user interface row set, and internally it does searches and you are going to be able to retrieve the result of those searches for internal purposes. Row finder, you cannot use it in the UI layer. It's only for internal management, okay? There is another component that is called AF target that is going to provide us the functionality that we need it. Sometimes we get a little bit dizzy or tired of having to play with the dependencies between fields. I mean, if you have one field that wants to be actualized with another, we have properties like partial trigger or thing like that. But we had some issues with the validation, because sometimes you want to send something, but you don't want to validate the whole page, and we have to play with the immediate and that have another issues. And with that component, with the AF target, we are going to be able to play better and easier with the dependencies between components. This is another nice feature that have been included in the 12c, that there is a dependency explorer. Okay, now if you in development mode, if you select an object, it's gonna show you in a real graphical structure the dependencies of those fields. This is quite nice for instance for beginners, because they are gonna be able to see in a blink of an eye the dependencies of objects. Also for experts, because if you just join a project that is already implemented and you want to be sure that that component, that V object, whatever, that application module have relation with another object, you are gonna see it in a very easy way. Okay. Talking about Maven, now we have full ABF Maven integration. In previous version we have Maven integration, but it was something that goes in parallel with the real library dependency in the JDeveloper project. And now is a kind of all of nothing. I mean, if you want to use Maven, you have to use Maven, and you are not going to be able to modify the library dependencies. If you go to your project and press right button to properties, if you go to the library, you're going to see disable. You're not going to see anything, because you are using Maven to handle your project, okay? Also, Oracle just created their artifact repository in order to do the continuous integration easier and to specify directly the repository of Oracle. And they, of course, they are gonna maintain this for us. Okay, now let's talk about REST. I hope all of you knows more or less what is REST. And now, in the same way that in ADF automatically expose web services with a web service interface that is going to expose all those services from an application module, now we have a new tab. It appears as a REST. And it's going to allow us to expose our business logic as with REST services. Okay, they can be exposed as XML or JSON. Okay, in this case, as you can see there, it's going to group them, or your services are going to be grouped by version, and also you are going to be able to have more than one version of the same service. As you can see there, for each resource, you are going to be able to specify if you want to expose that service with the creation, with the delete, with the update. Also, there is a new tab of attributes. There you can specify the attributes that you want to show or hide. This is an example of when you expose this, you're going to be able with a URL with your browser or with a client that you want to query that REST service and see the resources. For instance, there it appears a couple of resources, departments and employees, and it shows you like in the business layer with business components, all the elements, the attribute that it has and the properties. If that attribute it is updatable, if it is mandatory, etc. Okay, the precision of it, etc. Also, not only is gonna you are gonna be able to see the properties of the attributes, but also you are gonna be able to see links. I mean, if there is a master detailed structure of the if there is some LOVs there, or if that that field it is part of another structure, you are gonna be able to see the URL of that specific element in order to query that element and show the master detail structure, for instance. Also, we are going to be able to specify if we want to have pagination, if we want to show some specific attribute values, etc., or start from one element specifically, etc. Of course, not only this new 12c version is going to help us in order to expose REST services, but also it's going to help us quite a lot in order to consume those REST services. In the past, when we implement in 11g SOAP services, those were based in XML, and then in order to consume them, the only thing that you have to provide it is an XST. Now with REST, just because you can publicize not only with XML but also with JSON, it is a little bit more difficult in order to get those values. You have to create new methods and you have to parse them in order to really get the data that you want from the whole response, okay? In this case, ABF is gonna provide you a way of getting that information in a really simple way, thanks to the data control that all of you knows. Now, with a wizard, you are gonna be able to specify a URL and automatically it's gonna retrieve all the data that it needs and automatically show you in the same way that it was in the past as a data control all the elements that was in that URL query, okay? And for instance, on the left we see in the application resource the ABF REST connection that has a couple of elements, in this case departments and employees, and on the right you will see exactly like it would be in a business component structure, okay? Exactly the same with the elements. This is a master detail department employees, all the attributes. If you have view criteria, it will appear there, and you have a commit and rollback in the same way that business component will show you. Okay. Okay, that's all from my side. Let's see some of the conclusions. This new ABF 12c version improves have a lot of improvements, and of course there is bug fixes and some productivity and high flexibility and performance have been improved. Also, now we have Maven integration, it's easier to adapt to Forms application necessities. Now the R1 and R2 of the 11g disappear. Now we have only the R2 line, and it gets better stability. I think this is, well, I have attached here some references where we have retrieved that information. And if some of you wants to get more about all that information that we have shown, there you can go and see more details about the rich client components or the JDK 8, all the new features that it has. Okay. Thank you very much. I will now is Anator.
So thank you very much, Fernando. Thanks, Ruben, for your introduction. Well, we will start with the questions we have received through the system. So several participants have made some questions. I will start with the first one. Maybe we should detail or precise this question in the beginning of the presentation. And the question is, which ADF version exactly are you presenting?
Okay, this is what we have been talking about is a summary of all of ADF version. All of the 12c version. In reality, there are three of them, the 12.1.2, 12.1.3, and now the latest, the 12.2.1. For instance, the JDF query, the last improvement have been done in the 12.2.1, that is the latest, and the rest they came in the three of them. Okay.
Okay, so it's clear. We will continue with the questions. Second question, what would be your main reason to convince my company to invest of upgrading our ADF development to 12c?
Okay.
It's a large question.
Well, sometimes it's not simple. Well, my first idea is that just because we end up in HTML and unfortunately the object that understand the HTML it is a browser, we are continually dependent. We have a dependency of browsers and unfortunately. Browsers, we have several of them. They come from several companies. Sometimes those companies fight against each other, and sometimes how those browsers really understand HTML is different. And for that reason, companies that makes frameworks have to be always updating their products or the way that they show information in order to adapt to those new functionalities or necessities. And for that reason, if you want to be always on the edge of technology, you have to have the latest version of your provider. And of course, Oracle invests time and money in their latest version in order to show the information in the way that they want. And unfortunately, for previous version, they don't pay too much attention or they even forget about them. And in my opinion, if your clients use nowadays browser that they even actualize themselves, you have to have the latest version in order to always show what you want to do. Okay? Well, of course, there are lots of them, a part of the look and feel, of course, and also because nowadays people are getting more new devices, not only tablets, mobiles, or Internet of Things, watches, and all those devices are new, and of course, previous version didn't think about those devices.
Okay, we have another question from one of the attendees. It's more precisely regarding migration from 11G to 12C. So they are saying that we are thinking about the possible migration from 11G to 12C. Is there any special point to look at in order to do it successfully?
Okay, when we talk about the 11G, in reality there is two lines or two versions of 11G. The R1, all the 11.1x are the R1, and all the 11.2 is the R2. In reality, R2, it is the beta version of the 12C, okay? And then If you are moving from an 11R2 application to 12C, it's going to be almost the same. Almost. I mean, there is a very few percentage of modifications, and hopefully the J developer will do everything for you. If you are coming from the R1, okay, perhaps things that you have to look after is, for instance, in application models, for instance, they change the way of handling shared connections. And then if you have a hierarchical structure of application models, be careful, because they change their mind, and sometimes what in the past was that all connection is going to be shared, now only the application models that are the children of the others is going to have that elements. But the real damage or the real issue comes when you are when you have 10G version and you want to migrate to 11 to 12. In that case, especially in the view layer, you're going to have some difficulties and you have to go through them. But from the 11 to 12, it is not a big deal.
Of course, we can help you with that kind of things. We have a lot of experience in migration, so we can, for every client who are thinking about that migration, we can have an especially meeting with that and talk about that.
Of course. We
make recommendations, especially for that okay. situation and that client.
We have done even downgrades. I mean, in some situations, just because some clients want to do it in 12C and after that they change their mind and went to 11G, we have done downgrades in order to and more difficult, because JDeveloper helps you to go up, but doesn't help you to go down. And we have to figure out the solution to do that downgrade. Okay.
Okay. We have several more technical questions. One of them are, I never find the way of creating pages using the design mode. Do you usually use it?
In my case, I get used to use the structure window on the left, on the bottom. That window, if you get used to use it, it is quite useful. Well, I just says too many times use. But the design mode only helps you when you want to select something and you want to go to the source code. But in reality, there are so many components that go one inside to the other that the design mode is not going to represent you quite well exactly inside how it is. But I would recommend you to use the structure on the left, or the code itself, and you're going to be more sure that the modification that you have done, it is in the right place.
Next question. Debug mode got improved in terms of performance. Is it getting hung so often?
Well, as I said before, it gets better, and now if you are modifying a class, even in the model layer, you will see the web logic and gets updated, and it will really understand what that have been a change. But of course, not always. This is not 100% sure. Of course, that sometimes you have to stop the whole server, but not only because the debug mode itself, because the whole server, it gets heavier and heavier, and you have to stop it and start it again.
Thank you. Next question. Do you have good experience in GlassFish 4?
We have a couple of clients that already are working with GlassFish, and they are telling us that the performance is quite good. We have been working in consulting. We have been working with them as a consultants. And for instance, one of them have a little issue with the auto-commit, because it seems that the connection that by default JDeveloper or ADF gets from the database, the auto-commit was true, and we have to change it to false in order to be able to talk to the database from that GlassFish server. But the rest is almost like a well logic in terms of performance and the administration. Yes, that's it.
Okay. We have two more questions. We can answer to other questions if you wanted to make more. Next question is, talking in terms of skinning, do we need to change the layout that we use? Does it render in a different way?
Well, some of the components, a panel group layout, for instance, is going to be exactly the same. I mean, the only thing that really changes are the look and feel of the elements that have some shapes. I mean, for instance, tabs. The fusion skinning to the alta skinning, the look and feel is the same. The tab itself is the same, but instead of having a complete box, now in the 12C, it is almost the whole box, it is like is white and it has a little line on under that tab. And then if you have done lots of modification in the inline style or you have applied your own styles with a CSS, of course that you have to look after them and see if those changes now doesn't really apply. Internally, of course, that it has been modified, and even the name of some styles is going to be different, but in reality, the whole element is the same. I mean, we have to see one case after the other in order to figure out if you have, for that specific component, you have to start from scratch, or it's almost the same, or you have to add some padding or whatever, I don't know. Many situations, but in our case, I mean, when we have migrated, well, sometimes we are in project that just because there are so many modules and we implement the UE shell, some of the modules are already in Fusion and the main page is in Alta, and we are able to work with those two skins, and the look and feel is not so different, or at least the position of elements are not so different.
Okay, next question, and for the moment, the last one. Which components do you use to make responsive apps and touchable apps?
Okay, well, there are a lot of things to talk about that. Okay, first of all, when we talk about apps, we have to distinguish between mobile apps. I mean, if it is an app that is going to be stored in a mobile, or if we are talking about applications. If we talk about apps, that is mobile, and that ADF has his own framework, is called MAV, that is gonna help you in order to implement hybrid apps. Okay, in this presentation we didn't talk about anything about MAV. We are talking only about desktop applications. If we talk about the responsive, you have several solutions. For instance, there are some components that by default they are responsive, or they change their shape or the behavior of it depending of the resolution. For instance, the panel tab is it has as soon as the window gets so small, it will appear a button that is going to allow you to select the tabs that you don't reach. Also, if you want to do a responsive application, you can always use CSS media query in order to change the behavior with some media properties. Also, with EL expressions, in some places you can put a expression that is going to tell to the component, listen, if that component it comes from a tablet, or it is loaded from a tablet, you have to maximize always, or you have to do something. Or for instance, in tables, you can specify in the pagination or the way that you want to show the information, if you want to do pagination or scrolling, and then you put an EL expression in order to change depending on the device. Or for instance, if you have visual components, by default some of them are flash, and there are a few of them, but you can put an EL expression that says if you are in a tablet, use HTML5, okay? Things like that.
Okay, so thank you very much. It seems that there is no more question. Before closing the webinar, I will take the opportunity to tell you that this webinar has been recorded and will be uploaded it in the next few days to our YouTube channel. At the same time, of course, I invite you to participate to next WhatsApp in Tech webinars. And the following one is planned on June 14th, and it is dedicated to mobile testing. So, thank you very much for your assistance and active participation, and see you in the next session. Bye.